this Sunday lunch.
Hello, everyone, and welcome back to Mez's Sunday lunch after an extended Christmas break. We had some time off, but we're ready to go again. Isn't that right, Mez? All fueled back up.
I am fueled back up. I hope everyone had a good Christmas break. And guess what? It's Valentine's Day. Ooh la la. What a great day to start.
Exactly. We thought to ourselves, anyone on Valentine's Day is going to need a soundtrack to their romantic meal. And what better than Mez talking to us about this most hallowed of days?
Yeah, well, I Valentine's Day, it's all about love, isn't it? And, you know, I just feel so loved today.
good to know. Right. I'm gonna get you, Mez, to walk me through your perfect date. I think that would be a nice way to kick it off. But to start with, do you want to play us a track to get us in the mood?
Okay, so to get us in the mood, I'm going to go with Mr. Love himself, Serge Gainsbourg. I think that's how you say it. I'm never very good at pronunciation.
I don't think I've ever said it out loud, so we'll go with that.
And this is Jame with Jame Birkin.
There we go, a beautiful opening to what will, I'm assuming, be a beautiful show. So
it's always a beautiful show, but, you know, Valentine's Day, let's make it even more beautiful for those beautiful listeners out there.
Exactly. So, Mez, can you walk me through your perfect date? So you, right, set the scene, right? You've decided to go on the dating scene, and you've met someone who you think is the love of your life, right? What are you doing to impress them? What is the perfect date you're laying out for this person?
Ooh, this is a good one. So is this like, would I be like going out with them, or would it be like inside my house, or would it be like?
Well, I think there's two strands here, right? I think what is your perfect date in general? And then I think also we are going to have to delve into, you know, if you are hosting, what sort of romantic things are you going to do in the house? Stopping at the PG-13 range. No explicit bedroom scenes, please, Mez.
No. All right. Well, I think the perfect date for me would, you know, would be to just sort of not plan much in terms of like, I think if you booked a meal out or something like that, I think there's too much pressure there. Especially if it's a first date or it's someone that you've been, you know, you're really, really into and you know, like you say, you think it's love. I don't think you should just plan straight in there with a slap bang great meal. I think you should, you know, take it a bit like, you know, be a bit loose with it. So go out for drinks, go on a pub crawl and go dancing until the early hours of the morning and just chat away until, you know, don't even go to sleep, just chat all night, go dancing, drink lots, and just sort of get close that way, I reckon. That sounds romantic to me because you're just kind of like off the cuff, aren't you? I mean, that's how I would do it, and that's how I have done it before, you know.
What's the pub of choice? You know, you must have a couple. What sort of pub? I mean, obviously, not everyone listening is going to know the name of these pubs in Hull, but what kind of pub are you taking this person to as a starter?
Well, I think, all right, so this is the best way to do it, I reckon. So in Hull, what you would do is you'd get a train to Hesel Foreshore, which is about a 2-minute train drive. It's on the Cottingham and York line, so it's just underneath the Humber Bridge. There's a little pub on the Humber estuary. You'd go there first. In the summer they have a gin caravan in the beer garden, so you would, you know, there's a lot of different drink choices there. You could just imagine the sun beginning to set. It's early evening. This is where you start the night. It's the sun's just coming down over the Humber estuary. You're getting on the gins or whatever you want to drink, and then you jump back on the train after a couple of drinks there and a nice little bit of chit chat, and you go into town. You go down Humber Street in Hull, and there's various different places to drink there, but my favourite is the Minerva, which is a sort of like an old school pub. Again on the river, so it's quite nice. You're still staying on the waterline, and then you probably come to Priny Ave, which is where I live, HU5 area.
Convenient,
right? Hey, oi.
Slowly winding your way back to the flat above the ice cream shop, is it, Mez?
Exactly. Getting yourself back to the ice cream flat, and you'd probably go for a few drinks in the bars down here. There's a cool little speakeasy kind of independent bar called Dive, and you can go dancing there until the early hours. Sometimes they have lock-ins, if I'm allowed to say that. Just go with the flow. I think off the cuff, go with the flow. Lots of chit chat. I mean, that's what I did with my girlfriend, so worked for me, didn't it?
Well, I mean, there you go. 100% success rate in that case, right?
Exactly. But then again, you could also do something else. Well, I'll let you carry on.
No, I was going to say if that isn't an option, if you have to host them in your home, like what meal are you cooking them? Like, what are you doing to set the mood? You know,
seduce
within the confines of the flat.
Well, this is what you would do, right? You do a food extravaganza. So what I would do is my Well, basically, you've got to set the scene. So I'm talking mood lighting. I'm talking lamps. I'm talking candles. I'm talking incense. You know I like incense. I'm talking all of that kind of stuff. Get your froze back on the sofa. Get your pillows against the sofa, you know. Get it all nice and twinkly.
Where are they normally? What are you normally doing to the sofa? Where are the pillows normally placed?
Well, they're always there, but I mean, bash them on the floor, you know, get them to be a bit more pooty.
Oh yeah, fluff them back up. Yeah,
fluff them back out. Get your little lamps on. Get your candles out. Get your incense on. Plug in your vinyl player and pretend that you use it every day. And gently scatter some records near it. You know, some nice ones. You know, get all the mood going. You know, then what I would do is I would get two clean dressing gowns, hang them in the bathroom. Because you're going to probably have a bath with bath bombs, wine, candles, that kind of thing. But you want to make it like a spa. So you want to be hanging those dressing gowns in the bathroom. Plus, when you run that bath, they'll get a bit steamy and they'll get warm. Trust me, it works. They'll get a bit wet and warm.
Jesus.
And then you present the lovely person with a menu. And that is what you're going to do, and that is your extravaganza. I would go with a buffet of curries. I'd go with
Is curry a romantic meal? Feels to me like there could be some, you know, bowel issues a few hours after said curries.
Make them mild, but it's a way of showing you can cook different types of dishes all at the same time. Do you know what I mean? I would make a lentil dal. I would make a cabbage and potato curry. I'd make an aubergine masala. I'd make a spinach and paneer. I'd get some tasty little different breads like a puri and chapatis and naans. I'd steam some rice. Get it all sort of. And the good thing about that is you could actually cook a lot of these beforehand and put them in the fridge, because everyone knows that curries taste better once they've sat for a little bit. And then you dress the table, don't you? You know, you wipe the table down and you get it ready for the evening in terms of cutlery.
I'm impressed at how thorough that was, actually. You know, you were a Lothario on the down low, Mez.
Well,
I feel seduced from a distance, and I'm not even actually living out this evening, you know?
Hey, it works 80% of the time.
All right, should we have another song while we think about luxuriating in your bath of curries?
Okay, this is Scratchyard Lanyard by Dry Cleaning.
Do everything, feel nothing. Do everything, feel nothing. Pat Dad on the head, or at your big loud mouth. Thanks very much for the Twix. Myself is a hardy banana with that waxy surface and small, delicate flowers. A woman in aviators firing a bazooka.
Another lovely song.
It's a banger, that.
It is, yeah. I'm really looking forward to them when they put out an album. Yeah, really, really good band. One of those ones that it was kind of like they were going to be the ones to watch in 2020, and then there was like no 2020, but they've managed to kind of keep that momentum going. So I'm excited to see what they do.
I think they were on some of the shows that we did. I actually think they might have been on the last show we did in New York. I think they might have opened up, but I can't fully remember. It seems so long ago.
It does, yeah.
That was March, and again, you know, we're only a month away from that. But as I say, I've been doing some work on construction sites and stuff, and we've got a big big radio, and they've been on the playlist a lot on Six Music, and I've really been enjoying the song, so thought I'd play it on this lovely Valentine's Day.
Mm. Yeah, so anyone in the Hull area, if you walk past a building site, look out, because Mez could be in there with a pneumatic drill. So falling masonry is a potential.
Built for labouring. Built for labouring, built for rock and roll. That's what, you know, it says on my tombstone.
Which you've already bought. The second they put you on a building site, they went, you better get a tombstone, Mez.
Yeah, exactly. So I thought I'd, get ahead of the game.
Right, going back to Valentine's Day, I wanted to ask, what do you think is the most romantic thing that you've ever done for someone, Mez? Again, PG-13, please.
God, that's a tough question. I just think just sort of like paying attention and listening is the best thing that you can do. You know, I don't buy into the whole idea of, you know, it necessarily has to be a gift. I think it could almost be something that you just generally do day to day. And if you're always there for someone and you're always listening to someone, and you can be that person where someone can vent at you, and you can help them defuse that. And that's probably the most romantic thing you can do. But obviously, you know, you've got to be romantic as well in other areas. But we probably shouldn't talk about that.
That was quite touching until you got into that last bit, actually. So you're not one for no big romantic gesture. You never bought someone a giant teddy bear and taken them to see some fireworks with a bunch of flowers and a box of chocolates or anything?
No, I've not done that, but I have often suggested, let's get up early and go for a bike ride and watch the sunrise, stuff like that, you know? But
is that ever, right, I've never done this, but is that actually ever as nice as it sounds when you're not really tired? Because I feel like that's the kind of plan you make in the day, and then when you actually wake up to do it, you're like, fucking hell, what am I doing? Like, why am I doing this?
Yeah, I mean, it is touch and go, because the weather has got to be good as well. You know what I mean? So it's got to be a spur of the moment thing. You set your alarm, you surprise it. If it's sunny, it's good. If not, go for an evening walk. An evening walk through a graveyard or something.
Is a sunrise better than a sunset, in your opinion?
I think it is in a city, because if you can get out of the city just a little bit and watch the sunrise come up and then head back into the city into the morning, and then you go for brunch or something, don't you? Whereas I think like the sun setting is more of a holiday thing. I would always go with sun setting on a beach or a sun setting over a mountain or wherever you are on holiday.
Yeah, Butlins in Bognor, something like that.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
The sunset over the big top in Butlins, all the 2p machines glistening in the evening sun.
Well, we would have been at Butlins. We would have been at Butlins this in January, wouldn't we?
We would, yes. A very depressing month for that reason, mainly. Rockaway Beach, which I think we both thought when we started doing this podcast would probably be the first festival back.
I did think that would be the first festival back, but obviously the stop-start nature of these lockdowns and the inadequate government has meant, you know, a lot of people have been screwed over.
Exactly.
Everyone's been screwed over.
Everyone, unless any billionaires are listening, in which case, please stop listening and throw yourself in the sea.
Yeah.
What's the most romantic thing that someone's ever done for you, Mez? Has there ever been a moment when you thought to yourself, wow, this is a real romantic moment that has been planned for me? Or again, is this more of a sort of day-to-day thing for you?
No, my girlfriend's been pretty, she always says that she's not romantic, but she has done some really romantic things, and she nails presents. At the first, I can remember our first Christmas together 3 years ago. She knew that I'd lost like my vinyl player and everything like that. And I used to love listening to that. So she'd gone out of her way. She didn't really know anything about like the sound.
Sorry. Is this when you had done the date and pretended you listened to it all the time? So she was in her mind like, well, he's always listening to the records. He had them scattered around by the record player. I have to buy him a new one.
Well, you know. But yeah, she got me a record player, and it was a touching thing, because I'd gone on about having one, losing one through previous circumstances, and then, you know, it was the first kind of proper gift that she got me. So that was nice. That was romantic.
That is sweet and romantic. God, you really know, I'm living a romantic life up there in the north, aren't you? In London, it's all just sort of sadness and desolation, really.
Well, in the north, it is romantic, isn't it? It's a bit rough and ready romance, you know?
Yeah, well, I guess so. Rugged, you know?
Rugged romance up here. That's like, you know, we were born being romantic.
Come out of the womb with a bunch of roses in your hand.
Exactly. Who like that?
Right, have you got another track for us, Mez?
Yes, this is Arab Strap, and it's called Compersion Part 1.
You have seen all the ways my growing body walks, the successes and the failures, all its kinks and everywhere, you know its weakness well. Now let's try some fluid bonding in a lost hotel. And when we looked for a unicorn.
And there we go. Another Valentine's tune for us.
A bit of a left field one, but you've sometimes got to be a bit left field on when you're being romantic. You know what I mean?
I was going to say, I didn't see how that really tied into the romance, but you've already, you know, you've got a defense ready. This is the most prepared you've ever been for a show. You really are a romantic, aren't you, Mez?
Well, you know, I like to think of myself as a little bit of a romantic, mesmerized, as they say.
Of course, yeah. Well, I thought that was more just like, you know, oh God, what's Mez doing? That kind of thing. Can't take your eyes off. Like a car crash. Right. So you were obviously prepared for Valentine's Day. So I was thinking it might be nice for some of the listeners at home, bearing in mind this is coming out. This is a Sunday lunch, right? So this is coming out in the middle of Valentine's Day. So they might have an evening date coming up of some kind, whether it's a virtual date, whether they're just, you know, they've been living with their girlfriend or boyfriend for a while and they want to impress them. So do you have any tips for people who are nervous about a date? You know, ways to make sure it goes well, things to make sure you remember in case you might have forgotten them, you know, anything like that?
Well, obviously don't wear anything that shows up sweat patches.
Mm.
You know?
That's a good one.
If I wear a shirt and it's, I don't know, let's say like it's grey or off-white or something like that. And this applies to being on stage as well, but like, just don't wear that because you're going to get sweat patches, because when you're nervous, you start sweating. Just go for a nice, you know, do what the French do and wear black, you know? Just go cool. So you've got to think about what you're wearing and make sure that, you know, even if you are a little bit nervous and a little bit wet under the pits, it's not going to show. That would be my number one tip.
Of course, yeah, I think that's a very good one to open with. Any more gems for us?
Well, I would say, you know, make sure that you looked after yourself before the date. So maybe if that involves certain trimming certain areas, then have a go at trimming yourself.
Jesus, the quality of these tips nosedived pretty quickly there, didn't
it? I could just be referring to, you know, make sure you've had a shave.
Of course. Yeah, you don't want 5 o'clock shadow, do you?
No, well, that because it could irritate, you know.
Some that's state, true. Yeah, pulled it back.
You don't want people getting red rashes because they'll be like, "Whoa, am I allergic to that?" Him or her. You know what I mean?
I do, yeah. Another excellent tip. So they've got a couple of hours left. Let's say they're making dinner for their significant other, and they're listening to this at 3 p.m. They've got it on, as I'm sure millions of people across the UK will, got it on the digital radio, and they're about to start cooking, right? What do you think, if they're going to make one killer course, you know, what's the best to go for? I mean, I know you said there was the buffet of curries, but if you have to make one knockout dish, you know, what do you think's the one to go for?
Well, it's a tough one, isn't it? But I think depending, I mean, it's going to have to be a main course is your killer. But then, do you know what? I find puddings the hardest. So maybe it's more impressive to just knock out a killer pudding, because you could have like, because your main course could still be quite romantic. It could be like a cheese board. It could be just picky bits, and then you whack out this amazing pudding that's obviously taken time to make, because, you know, baking or whatever.
Yeah, I think puddings come in two categories, don't they? What, it's either really, really like insultingly easy, or actually takes quite a long time to make. Like, you would never spend as long on a main course as you do on a pudding, I don't think. Like, if you're making like a cake or something like that,
that's
hours.
What I mean. Yeah, like a cake or like a sponge of sort, like a, you know, that kind of like level of pudding cooking is hard. It's hard. Like, so that is pretty impressive. I'm rubbish at that stuff. But, you know, I'd always go main course, because I feel like you can almost bluff your way into making that good, because, you know, anyone can do a nice, simple pasta dish and it still come across as quite a well-cooked meal. Do you know what I mean?
I feel like with a main course, it's like you say with pasta and that, it's all about how it tastes, to it, like, as long as it doesn't look like absolute shit. Whereas with a pudding, you kind of expect it to look nice, don't you?
Well, that's the
like
thing,
a cake, you need it to look fancy.
They have to be aesthetically pleasing, don't they? They have to be pleasing on the eye, whereas, you know, a curry, you know, in a bowl, it could taste amazing, but it, you know, it's just a curry in a bowl.
Yeah, it's never gonna look as good as a well-made,
you know,
cake,
you know,
is it?
People, when they go full leg with the full hog with puddings, you know, we're talking sugar baskets, we're talking icing sugar dusting on plates and all that kind of malarkey. That just blows my head. That,
yeah, like what are those like brandy snap like baskets you get in a fancy restaurant?
Exactly.
That they make on like the back of a ladle or something weird, you know, that,
yeah,
kind of stuff.
You see them on TV and they're just like firing a spoon around some kind of like cold air and a basket.
Yeah, it never helps, does it? You watch those shows.
In my house, it'd be all over the bloody surfaces and everything. That's not romantic, is it?
That is the worst thing when you watch a cookery show. Desserts, they always make them look incredibly easy, and then the second you try it, you've like set fire to the curtains or something in the next room somehow.
Yeah, exactly. So, I mean, I would say a pudding is very, very showstopper. It's like a whoa, but I think you need to have a good level of experience of that in order to pull it off. So I would then go with, if you're not feeling confident, go for flavor and go for something that you love to cook and you know that you're amazing at, and then just tweak it slightly so it just elevates it a little bit more. But at least you know.
That is the key, isn't it? You don't try something new on Valentine's Day.
Try something tried and tested that for you might be a little bit boring, but for someone else who's never had that recipe from, well, from yourself, then, you know, it's going to be a knockout, isn't it?
That's true.
That's my advice, mate.
That is, again, surprisingly good advice. You are like
a
sort of Cupid figure.
I've come back a new person. I've ditched the mushy peas, yeah. And I've come back a new person.
This is what I was expecting. This is what I was dreading. I was like, God, I'm going to ask Mez about a romantic meal, and he's going to like say mushy peas in the shape of a heart or something.
Nah.
But we've done all right, you know?
You've got, sometimes you've got to go deeper. Substance, love.
Okay, let's have another song, and then I'm going to ask you what the best way to your heart is, Mez, if I was going to try and seduce you, which I feel we're way past anyway. You're madly in love with me, but, you know.
This is true, and I guess I should play this next song to save my embarrassment blushes here. But this is Water in the Well by Jame.
Crawl on
another great track. We had Charlie Steen from Shame on the show a few weeks back, on the main show, Down with Boring, and he discussed spaghetti and an Italian mountain village for about 15 minutes. So if anyone's interested, that's available on all of your Spotify and all of that. Great album.
Yeah, great album. And particularly enjoying this track, Water in the Well. Again, it's been a soundtrack in my manual work, so it's been good to hear. Gets you in the mood.
Yeah, it's also good. I mean, they did it with their first one, but releasing an album in this sort of dead period, I love that. You come out of Christmas and the New Year and you're like, oh, what have I got to look forward to? And then bang, new Shame album, middle of January.
Well, no, I think January is a perfect time to release music. And I also, like, hats off to everyone who's got their records able to, to the point where they can release now. I think it's brave releasing albums at the moment. And, you know, if our album was ready, we would be releasing it right now as well, just because, you know, I think as artists, you've got to be brave. And so hats off to artists like Shame who are just cracking on.
Yeah, 100%. And working around this stuff, like, you know, doing that live stream and things on it, because you can't do the normal promo, can you? You know,
no.
So it's like Valentine's Day. You can't do the normal Valentine stuff. That's why we're here to help, aren't we, Mez?
That's why we're here, you know, so make sure that you've quickly found your dressing gowns and hanging them in the bathroom, so that when you do run that nice steamy bath, they sort of, you know, get almost the temperature of the water that you're gonna dive into,
like the kind of hot towel that you can get on if you're on a fancy flight. You can get a hot towel, can't you? That
exactly.
Sort of vibe.
We're just recreating those kind of things, but within lockdown.
Okay, Mez. So the scenario is you are single. Obviously, that's not the case, but if you were, and someone has seen your picture from this podcast, listened to you, and for some demented reason decided that they want to seduce you, what is the best way to your heart, Mez? What do you think is something that's important to you, something that would, you know, really, if you click with someone on that, then you know that, you know, next Valentine's Day, you'll be spending it with them.
I mean, I think they've really got to sort of, like, be embracing of the food substance that is cheese.
Of course. I was literally there like, where's he going with this?
No, like, you know, I always can remember, like, especially with Farah, my girlfriend, like, when we were starting out and stuff like that, I always used to be like, what's your five favorite cheeses, or what's your five favorite flavors of crisps, or just daft stuff like that, like, really, to sort of, like, because it's that kind of daft stuff that you always remember. And but yeah, so to, you know, if you want to woo me, you've got to talk well about a good cheese board.
Well, also, probably a fan of smoked cheeses and not snobby about them, you know.
Exactly.
I mean, some people say that they're not really an artisan cheese.
Exactly. And when I went to Glasgow and I went to this famous cheese shop on Byers Road, and I was,
if,
like,
you can call it that without any smoked cheeses there.
Exactly.
You know?
And I was like, he was like, what do you want? And he was like, this cool guy, he was a hipster from Glasgow. I'm like, oh, here we go. And he was like, what do you want? What do you want? And I was like, well, I'm really into smoked. And he's like, I'm artisan, we don't do smoked. And I'm like, all right then.
And you said, I will never spend a Valentine's Day with you, sir.
Exactly. And that's what I said. And then I said, that cheese there, what is it? He was like, da 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 da. I was like, I'll take it. He gets it to the till, 20 quid. I didn't care. Bing. See you later.
20 quid is such an obscene amount of money for cheese. And when you first told us, I think it was the first episode of the podcast, I think, that this came up.
Yeah.
And I'm still reeling from the price of
that
cheese.
I'm still reeling. I didn't even eat it. I think it went off on the train home. But, I was determined. There was no way I was going to be like, after he told me that artisan cheesemakers don't believe in smoked cheese, and then I tried this one that he, like, shoved under my nose, and then I was like, yeah, that's great, I'll buy it. If he then said, oh, that's 20 quid, and I'd be like, ooh, that's a bit expensive. I wasn't going to be that person, was I?
Yeah, plus then you open yourself up to 10 minutes on why it's so expensive, and who's got time for that, you know?
Yeah, I mean, I just wanted to get out of there. I should have just chucked the fucking cheese back at the window. I'm like, how'd you like them apples? Like, I didn't.
So, the way to your heart is a decent knowledge of and enjoyment of cheeses, but not necessarily incredibly expensive ones, you know?
No, it could be Babybel.
Derrily Triangles, I'm a big fan of.
Yeah, I like, you know what I've been getting into? Seriously strong, spreadable. Have you, you know, the seriously strong cheddar that you can get, but they do a spreadable. Yeah.
Right, I didn't know they did a spread. What is that? Does it, because that has the, like, the strong one has like the crystals in it, right?
Yeah, but it's not. Exactly. And this is like claggy, almost, it's like a tub of Vaseline, but tastes of cheese.
Oh my God, that sounds horrible. That does not sound like a Valentine's treat to me, Mez.
Check it out, man. Like, honestly.
Cheesy Vaseline is how... This is a man who enjoys it, and he's telling me it's claggy Vaseline cheese. Like, well, that doesn't sound good.
It's only a quid as well in a shop that I frequent sometimes.
Yeah, I can't imagine why. You're probably the only person buying it.
And it's quite tasty. It's quite tasty.
No, absolutely not. What is the worst thing that you can get for Valentine's Day that isn't an STD, Mez?
The worst thing? The worst thing you could get on Valentine's Day that isn't an STD? Probably a punch in the face, right? That won't be good.
Yeah, that's true.
Especially if you like
hey, wrapped it.
You know, if you like your own face, why don't you want it punching?
That's true. That is true. Yeah. Plus, if you like the person doing the punching, that's a double, isn't it? Because if you thought the date was going well and then you get punched in the face, not ideal.
You're sparked out and you've got a black eye. Come on, that's not a look that you want. And it's not something you want for Valentine's Day.
You know? I think that's fair. I think, yeah, that's probably the right answer then, isn't it? A punch in the face is the worst Valentine's present.
Or like a moldy egg, like a pack of moldy eggs.
A pack of moldy eggs.
Yeah, like, oh, I got you some eggs. Oh, by the way, they're out of date. Well, why do I want that?
What? Eggs a gift anyway? Do they cost enough to be a worthwhile gift?
Well, probably not, and that's why it would be a rubbish gift.
That would be. I feel like that's more, I think the punch in the face I can see happening more than a packet of moldy eggs.
Well, if I, next time I see you in the flesh and I come up with a packet of moldy eggs, what are you going to think? You're going to be like, what is going on?
Well, I think the worst thing about that is you wouldn't know they were moldy until you tried to use them. So you'd take the eggs and you'd carry them home and you'd keep them with you all that time. Yeah, and then you go to make an egg in the morning. You'd be like, oh, yeah, great. Well, like, a boiled egg.
Exactly. You might be making a sexy omelette and then suddenly, bang, they're green. Whoa, what about bad gift?
That would be a shit present, yeah. So a punch in the face and a packet of moldy eggs are the worst gifts.
A bag of raisins. I hate raisins. I hate raisins. A bag of raisins is a bad gift.
Yeah, I mean, I guess that is true. That is also true. I can't fault the logic. I like raisins, and I still think that would be a shit gift.
It is, isn't it? Like, why would I want something that's going to get stuck in my teeth?
You know what annoys me about raisins? You can't rehydrate them. No. It would be much better if you could put them in water and they turn back into grapes.
Exactly.
You know, like travel grapes.
Like, what is the point of them? What is the point of a raisin?
Well, to taste like a raisin, I guess. What's the point of moldy eggs?
Well, exactly. There isn't a point to them. So is there a point to the raisins? Probably not.
I think we're a bit too bogged down in raisin chat here. Let's rescue ourselves with a song. And then I'll have a few more Valentine's tricks up my sleeve afterwards.
Okay, this is All Along the Uxbridge Road by Chubby and the Gang.
There we go. Wasn't that romantic, I don't think, as far as songs go.
It's not a romantic song, but it's got, like, you know, it's nice and up-tempo, and, you know, it's getting to that point in the afternoon where someone needs an up-tempo track. So there you go.
That's true. Yeah. Okay. Right.
It gets your adrenaline going again, ready for the evening, ready for the evening activities.
Yeah, but you'd have to listen in private. It would spoil the mood if you put it on the when the lights were low, you know?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, yeah. Definitely.
Put your headphones in, quickly listen to that, then back to cooking your mouldy egg omelette.
Exactly.
Right, I've got a game for you now, Mez.
No.
Yeah, it's... right, so you have been tasked with making a Tinder profile for each of your band members, each of the members of Life, right? They've all come to you and they've said, Mez, I'm unlucky in love. Can you write me a Tinder biography that is going to make people want to date me? So a one-line bio for each member of your band for them to court potential girlfriends and boyfriends. So what would you write for Mick? What would his one-line bio be on Tinder?
Oh, I mean, this is a blooming hard question.
Well, you could do anything. You could just write, like, you know, a few of his interests, or you could maybe, is he the kind of guy that's going to make sort of a bad pun? You know, is there a fun fact about him that you want people to know?
Mick's great with puns. Mick's great with, you know, he's a funny chap. He's artistic and all that. But if it was me and I was making his profile, I'd just be like, hi, my name's Mick the Dick. And because I just think that would really, you know, a picture of him, and then it literally says, my name's Mick the Dick.
And that would be intriguing, wouldn't it?
It's a hook, isn't it? It's a hook. Mick the Dick. Who the hell is that guy? I want to know who he is. Mick the Dick.
Yeah, I guess so. Okay. what about Stu?
Well, Stu, obviously, he's very caring, and he's the adult one in the band, so I would go with something like, hey, I'm Daddy Stu.
Wow. I thought you said you were the adult in the band.
Yeah, but...
Or you were the mum and he was the dad, or he was the mum and you were the dad?
No, I was like, yeah, I'm more of like the mum figure. He is always the dad, so it's like, you know, if this was his profile, it'd be like, my name is Daddy Stu. And again, that's pretty bold, isn't it?
That's quite forward, I think. I think you're gonna turn off a lot of casual interest, but the people that stick around are probably gonna be in it for the long haul.
Yeah, but I'm talking about we need to get the diehard, the core users of that platform to really embed with my band members. I don't want some fleeting fancy. I want the core users. The core users.
Yeah, I think that's fair.
They deserve the true core love. Users. True love, yeah.
Okay. And obviously that leaves Lydia, I guess.
I know this one's gonna be hard because what could Lydia's one liner be? My name's Lydia and I will love you forever.
Wow, again, very intense. You really are going for the hardcore here, aren't you?
Well, I think a lot of people,
their bio, they try and make it sound, they try and get a kind of large but shallow pool and then kind of weed them out from there. But you're going straight in like, look, if you're not fully interested, get the fuck out, right?
Well, yeah, exactly. And Lids is one of the most loving and caring people I've ever known. So I would like, you know, I think it's a befitting one-liner for her.
Fair enough. And Mez, what would yours be?
Well, it would just be Mez, wouldn't it?
That'd be it. That'd be your bio. Just the word Mez.
Exactly. Exactly. Because then people would be like, what is that?
So it would say Mez, and then there'd be a picture of you, and then underneath it would just say Mez again.
Yeah. Double Mez.
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 Yeah, I think it's probably for the best that you stick with your current girlfriend, to be honest. Or at least get her to write you a bio before she leaves.
No bio needed. Maybe that's what it would say. Mez, no bio needed.
Wow. That's meta, you know?
Is that better?
That
would definitely get some core fans there, wouldn't it? Some core users of that platform.
I don't know. I think people would probably just think you're a bit of a prat, to be honest.
Hey, and that is a common thing that I do find in general life.
A common struggle.
Yeah.
Okay. Right. Okay. One more song, and then I've got a final question for you after the song, and then I guess that will wrap up the Valentine special. So what track do you want to play us?
Okay, well, we opened up the show with Serge Gainsbourg, And we're going to close the show with Serge Gainsbourg. This is Bonnie and Clyde.
Définitivement abîmé. Bonnie and Clyde, Bonnie and Clyde. Qu'est-ce qu'on n'a pas écrit sur elle et moi? On prétend que nous tuons de sang-froid. C'est pas drôle, mais on est bien obligé de faire taire celui.
There it is, Bonnie and Clyde. The final question for you, Mez, on this most romantic of days is Jesus Christ, Paddington Bear, and Keanu Reeves. You got to fuck one, marry one, and kill one. Who are you going for? So you got Jesus, you got Paddington Bear, you got Keanu Reeves.
I've got to fuck one, kill one, and marry one.
Yeah.
Is that what you said?
That's correct.
Well, I'd kill Jesus Christ. Not needed.
Okay, all right.
Not needed. He's had his inches.
Not needed. He died once and came back, so
exactly.
If you kill him again, he might come back.
He might come back, so, you know, I'm not an advocate of killing people, so at least if I killed this person, he might come back again. And as I say, he's had his inches. He's had his time in the sun. Jog on. So, yeah. And then, well, I'll probably have to fuck Paddington. Just because he's cuddly.
Okay.
He's cuddly.
Bold.
He's cuddly. He's exotic. See you later. Likes marmalade.
I assumed you'd marry Paddington.
You what?
I assumed you would marry Paddington because he seems like quite a wholesome spouse to have. I mean, I know you love Keanu, but I thought maybe you'd want some lust-filled action with Keanu.
No, because if you marry Keanu, that means I get to, like, you know, hear his stories every day. And he doesn't have to be lonely on that bench eating a sandwich anymore because I'll be next to him eating a sandwich.
That's true. Yeah, you're thinking of him, really, aren't you?
Exactly. So there you go. Kill Jesus, fuck Paddington, marry Keanu.
And there you have it. Is there anything more romantic than that game to finish us off? This has been Mez's Sunday Lunch. We'll be back next month. There's no extended hiatus this time. Goodbye from me. And I guess goodbye from you too, Mez, yeah?
Yes, goodbye. And I hope you all have a wonderful rest of your Valentine's Day, and may love live long in your lives.
Oh, adorable.
If you've got sausage and mash and gravy, Yorkshire pudding and roast potatoes,